In this video, we'll describe more ways to solve for equilibrium concentrations or pressures. Most of the solutions that we're going to be working with this semester will have a second order factor in them, a second order polynomial. Realize that for a second order polynomial, we can always use the quadratic. What we're trying to describe are shortcuts that we can look for to avoid having to use that. The first one is the method of perfect squares that we've already worked with our hydrogen iodide reaction. The second one that we're going to work now is if we have a small k value indicating that we have a reactant-favored system, we can assume that the amount of change in our change line is going to be very small, and therefore x is going to be close to zero. So this is the method we're going to focus on in this video. Our next video, we'll use an example of the quadratic. For our sample problem, we're going to work with this one, the combination of nitrogen and oxygen at 300 Kelvin, where we have this Kc value. Again, notice we're given starting amounts of our reactants in moles. So we need to use our volume to convert that into molarity. So remember, molarity is moles per liter. And again, we're going to assume that X is small because our Kc is small. And our cutoff for this is anything less than 10 to the minus 3. Because we're going to make an assumption, we're going to cover how we check that assumption to make sure that it's valid. And so again, here is our problem that we're going to be working. And the first thing you should notice is that we need to balance our chemical equation. We always have to start with that balanced equation. Writing our chemical equation so that we can show our ice table underneath it. I'm going to include that fourth row of the equilibrium as a reminder to solve for the final equilibrium amounts. And of course, I need to calculate the molarity of each substance. So my moles divided by my volume. For purposes of showing work, I don't need to see this specific setup. I assume that you know how to do it. What I look for is that you have the correct starting amounts. So we know our nitrogen and oxygen concentrations. We're not told anything about NO, so we assume zero. And so that means our reactants are going to decrease while our products increase. Nitrogen decreases by X, oxygen decreases by X, and NO increases by 2X. We add those two lines together to get our first equilibrium line. So those are steps one and two. Step three is writing our equilibrium expression as products over reactants. Coefficients are the exponents. And then step four is plugging in equilibrium values to this equation. And setting this equal to our Kc value. So again, we have a math equation to solve here. The quadratic will work for this. So if you're comfortable with it and familiar and it's quick for you, feel free to use the quadratic. I'm trying to show a shortcut so that you don't have to use the quadratic. So again, here we have our ice table and our setup. And again, the purpose of this one, or the shortcut we're going to use, is because we're saying that this is a reactant-favored system. At equilibrium, we're going to have mostly reactants in our container. And so that means that the amount of change has to be very, very small in order for this to be true. And so we're going to assume that any x that is added to or subtracted from a number is going to be zero. So again, any x that's added to or subtracted from a number, we can assume that x is going to be zero. In other words, I can't make this numerator x go to zero, or I have no math equation to solve. So I'm going to set up my equation again so I can go through the steps here. and show you how we would solve this one for our assumption and how we check our assumption. So again, these denominator x's are going away. That leaves me with the quantity 4x squared in the numerator. And when I multiply my 0.8 times my 0.2, I get 0.16 in the denominator. I don't need parentheses. I don't know why I just wrote them. And now we follow our regular algebra order of operations. And again, in this step where we take the square root, we're only going to take the positive root. We can't have a negative value for concentrations or pressures, and so we never work with the negative root from a square root. X is not our final answer, so we're going to keep extra digits here. And again, before I go back in and plug values in to solve for my final equilibrium values, I want to check my assumption. The equation we use to check the assumption is that I put x over my initial concentration multiplied by 100 because I'm essentially calculating a percent error. And as long as we're less than 5% error, then our assumption is valid. So for our setup, we have our x value. And now remember, for this problem, we actually have two initial quantities. We have both the 0.8 and the 0.2. Normally, most problems we work, we only have one initial. So I don't want to do this calculation twice. You're welcome to. I don't want to, though. So I want to put the value in here, the initial concentration that's going to give me the larger number in the end. What you should realize is the smaller the number in the denominator, the larger my final answer will be. So you're welcome to check this, but if I do this with the 0.2, then it should also work for the 0.8. For our check, we don't care about sig figs. We just want to know that we are less than 5%, and that is good to go. And so now we can go back and look at our final values after we plug x in. So for nitrogen, we have the 0.80 minus our x value. Realize once you plug those in and then round for the decimal places, right, we're subtracting, so two decimal places, we actually end up with the exact same molarity here. For oxygen, I'm going to do the same thing, subtracting out my x when I write it correctly. And again, when we round for sig figs, going to the two decimal places because of subtraction, we get the exact same value as we started with. So what might commonly happen is that you get the same value. Sometimes you'll see this decrease enough to change it in the last digit. So maybe a 0.79 or a 0.19. But when we assume that x is small, it essentially means that our reactant concentrations are not going to change very much. And then, of course, our last step in here, I just saw this other typo. Sorry, my NO should be a 2x in this table. And so to solve for NO, I'm going to multiply x times 2. And when I round for the two sig figs because of K and my initial quantities, and I just noticed my oxygen also has a typo. So when I round for final values, I get 0.0013 molar for my final NO concentration. Again, we can quickly see that we have more reactants than products, and so that matches our Kc value. If I wanted to more carefully check, then I would plug these values in to my expression and confirm that I get close to this K value.